Here.
Stein?
Here.
Mormon?
Here.
Tidwell?
Here.
Stacker?
Here.
Terry?
Okay, number two, approval of agenda.
Any changes, Your Honor?
No changes this evening.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call the roll.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Mormon?
Yes.
Tidwell?
Yes.
Stacker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Bird?
Here.
Yes.
Okay, number three, presentation of petitions and other communications. A, City of Boone Downtown Resident Survey, 2018-2019. We have Kurt Phillips here this evening to discuss.
All right. Thank you for the time, Your Honor, and counsel for allowing me to talk about not only downtown, but retail in general. This is something we've been working on quite a while. I know I sent a lot of information to you, and rather try and go through that piece by piece. Hope you have a chance, if you haven't already, to go through it, because there's a lot of interesting information and a lot of comments as well. My goal today is to kind of recap how we started, how we got where we are today, and also maybe kind of talk about where we're going. So, timeline. The Chamber of Commerce started looking into the downtown initiative back in the fall of 2016. We formed a retail task force with a goal to investigate these challenges that we do face in rural America, downtown Boone, just like other communities, and to hopefully find a way to measure the gaps in goods and services, as well as assess the local citizens' attitudes towards those goods and services, to find out which ones they would actually support if they were provided in the community. Part of this research that was about a year later in August of 2017, it went to Sioux City for the Iowa Downtown Conference, was able to hear stories of similar challenges around the state of Iowa, but also was able to see proof that it could be done. It could revitalize downtown communities. Sioux City is a good example of that. There were many other examples. And it really further entrenched my belief that we had work to do here locally, but we also have the bones to revitalize this community. And over that time, I was also researching ways that we could measure this. We wanted hard data. We didn't just want opinions. Up to that point, that's all we had was people's conjecture, thoughts, opinions. So we made connections with Iowa State University. They have some great resources over there. One of them was CD Dial, that is the Community Development Data Information Analysis Laboratory. And that is a program that designs surveys and then analyzes them statistically to give you some level of confidence in the results. We also work with David Swenson. Most folks have met him or heard of him, along with his partner, Lisa Lakeson, at Iowa State University, Department of Economics, whole retail gap data from public resources. Fall of 2018, you guys decide to do the Marketing Hometown America Initiative. Now that seems like it's outside the scope of what I'm talking about, but really it correlates with it, and it's been a great thing to do, and the small groups that formed out of that have really come to a lot of the same conclusions that we're going to get to here in the end. So eventually the Chamber came back. We had made one presentation a year earlier. We came back about a year later, presented to Economic Growth, to the Economic Development Committee of the city. We got a partnership put together along with Ogden Telephone, CDS Global, and we did the community assessment survey, which took place or started late November of last year, went through about mid December, and then we compiled those results, or CD Dial did, in the late winter and early spring of this year. In the meantime, while all of that is going on, we're all watching a bit of an exodus from downtown. Not just one, and not just two, I mean, all of a sudden five, six, seven businesses are leaving for what they would believe to be greener pastures, higher traffic counts into the newer area of town. So if there was ever a time to really start thinking about this, it definitely was at this time. And this really was tail to tape on the dynamic of retail in the core business districts of rural America. So we were seeing what a lot of other communities had already seen. When businesses decide to leave an area because they perceive it to not be fruitful enough for them to survive, usually what you see is landlords eventually lowering rents to attract entrepreneurs back. Low rents, however, while they're very good for running a part-time or hobby-style business, are not good for cash flow and maintaining buildings or upgrading them. You've got a vicious cycle going on here. And when you can't maintain them or update them, they deteriorate, and less people want to go in them, less people are in your downtown. And again, kind of a vicious cycle. So Jim Thompson, who spoke at our chamber annual meeting, said that your downtown will eventually turn into the lowest cost storage, and that's not what you want. 3 weeks ago, I walked around before I met with the Economic Development Committee. If you think Keeler Street to Allen Street, get that in your head, 9th Street to 6th Street, not very many blocks, they had about 20. 23 businesses, 16 empty storefronts, and another seven that were part-time businesses, maybe 3 to 4 days a week or less, they were open. And they look it most of the time. 23, Keeler to Allen, 9th to 6th. Okay, so we know we got a challenge here we're trying to take care of. What did we learn from the community assessment survey? 1,000 of those were sent out, 235 came back. We wanted a few more than that, we were shooting for 300, but you know what, 235 is not bad. In fact, I think if you did get in there, you'll see it was about a margin of error on the answers of about 6.23%, a little higher than you'd like, but still pretty reliable information. And the tale of the tape from the citizens in response to what they thought of downtown was this: we'll go there to eat a little bit, we'll go to the shop a little bit, of course, banks, we'll go banking, maybe a financial advisor, but that's about the only reason you go downtown. And they might go 1 to 2 times per month, if we're lucky, but most of them only go about 5, 6 times a year. And again, it's just validating the challenge that we have before us. Why don't they go downtown? Now, they don't feel it's very inviting for a number of different reasons. Certainly, family-wise, other than maybe taking the kids to a restaurant, right? It doesn't necessarily have the types of products and services that they want or would drive them into downtown more often. It didn't have things like things they wanted: nightlife, recreation, arts, culture. Special events are some of the things they said they would come downtown for, and if it was a little more pedestrian-friendly. A number of different answers were out there. They did put the onus on yourselves, as well as my organization, the Chamber of Economic Development. I think it was almost 76 to 77% of the people responded, we have a responsibility to take care of that downtown and do something with it. So hopefully this is really a great start towards that. In your packet, you would have seen just a simple graphic, a retail gap study. That's the data from ESRI, which is the Environmental Systems Research Institute. And that's just pulled from a number of different data points and sources all over the globe. They bring that all in, and they can get fairly close to what's actually going on in terms of leakage of sales outside of our community, which, by the way, the number one community we leak sales to is Ames. Number two is online, the community of online. And Ankeny and Des Moines follow in at 3 or 4. But in that piece that I sent you, it talks about areas that we have tremendous leakage, to include recreational vehicles, that can be boats, RVs, ATVs, motorcycles, electronics, appliances. It did have footwear in there. Footwear is a very difficult proposition for small towns or almost any retail anymore because that's an online business. Sports and hobby stores, department style stores, floral shops, and then, not surprisingly, something we hear a lot about around here, restaurants, pubs, specialty food service type places. Those categories together are over $60 million estimated in leakage. Imagine the tax that can come from that. And that correlated really well to the community assessment answers from citizens about the business growth that they most desire. Number one request, food, 74% indicating that, and entertainment was 62%. Marketing Hometown America, we heard very, very similar answers. But here's some of the things that came out of not only Marketing Hometown America, but even Terry ran his Facebook simple post, hey, what do you think? You have people that are passionate about the community. They will step in. I think they will. They want to see it better. And downtown still matters to them. So here's kind of my wrap, my final take on it. 2011, the city of Boone passes the resolution to start the Jumpstart Boone program. Excellent program. Probably not taken advantage of as much as it could be, but a great program to abate taxes when you put money into your property to increase its value, but really make it a better place. 2014, you do beat it. I don't know, we got 15, 16 or so businesses deep into that. That's got facades renewed, and it's been a real positive step. We got to do a lot more than that. And so movement's underway. Again, Councilman Mormon kind of taking the lead on that to get Ethan's story turned into a public place. Make it more inviting and a place you want to come down to. And then I know you've got on your agenda to talk about a business grants program. It's a great step. These are all solid programs, and it gives me a chance then to go sell this community. I got a lot of tools in the toolbox right now. They're getting better all the time. To go out to somebody and say, come here, because look at all the data we have, look what the community has said, look what the city's doing to make this a place to do business. So I applaud you for the efforts you made so far and the things that you're considering. So in conclusion, again, at our annual meeting, Mr. Thompson quoted as saying, if you love your downtown, it will love you back. And this is more than just the downtown. The downtown is the heartbeat of the community. So with that, I believe that with the data that we've collected, the partnerships that we've got between the Chamber, Economic Development, and the city of Boone, and then with community support, we can really make a difference in the downtown.
standing committees, A, policy administration, DJ.
No report.
Public safety, Stephen.
No report.
Utility committee, Stephen.
No report, but we'll have a meeting on the 10th, 4:30.
Okay, economic development committee, Greg.
Yes, Your Honor, we got several things tonight. Number one, discuss approve, new downtown business grant. Bill?
I'll try to get to one, it's not moving. I got a paper copy.
Okay.
Okay, so this is the revitalization Boone downtown business grant that we budgeted for fiscal year 20. There's $5,000 budgeted for either a one-time grant or two grants of $2,500. I'll just get some votes so you all can see this. Before we came up with grant requirements for this, what the grant will fund, what the grant will not fund, which I'll go over payroll, employee compensation, state, local, federal taxes, business startups outside the city's designated downtown district, fines related to health and safety. So those are some of the things that will not fund. Some of the things the grant will fund are capital expenditures related to the purchase of a downtown building, building improvements, structural aesthetics, expenses related to the purchase of machinery, equipment, or tools needed to operate the business, marketing or advertising campaigns, signage, and utility expenses. Some of the special considerations that we'll be giving for this grant, of course, some of what Kurt just talked about, restaurant, deli, or other retail food service, which is one of the areas that he spoke about, sports, bar, pub, or grill, recreation or entertainment venue for use, sporting goods, or product niche or gift stores. At the last Boone County Economic Growth Committee meeting, the city asked the group if they would be willing to match the grant for fiscal year 20, and they did choose to do that, so that's another $5,000 that we can use toward this grant. So we have a total of $10,000 for fiscal year 20. And I'm assuming that could be two grants as well, $2,500, if the Economic Development Committee so chooses. Any application will go in front of the committee and they'll decide. And it'll be pretty much like VDEP, we'll apply, make a site visit, and look at the project obviously before they vote on any fund that will be allocated toward it. The only thing I really didn't go over is the grant requirements. I can read those, there's about nine of them. I have no idea why this whole load is.
Yeah, I mean, we have it in our packet, and we'll get it out there publicly too on the website here moving forward if we agree on this tonight.
So the EB committee has approved this. So I think what we're looking for tonight, one, any comments from council or any requirements or anything you want to add. Otherwise, if it looks good to you, we will bring this back in the form of a resolution for the August 5th City Council meeting for your approval.
The only thing that we also need to decide tonight is I've been talking to Rick Sanders, the new ISU Research Park Director, and also partnering with them in the startup engine over their names. And he is interested in participating in a partnership with Boone on startups and games that potentially land new businesses here at Boone. We're already starting to see that in the industrial park. And then this way, we'll have these businesses that are phasing out of their program and looking to move into a program here in Boone on a permanent statute. So they're moving out of Research Park, starting a full-time business on their own 2 feet. So he's interested in that as well moving forward. Questions? Okay.
Well, it'll be passed in the form of a resolution, so I don't know if we need a motion tonight.
Yep.
Yeah. This is more information if you guys have any input, and we'll pass it on all the stuff.
Update on IDOT presentation on July 9th. Administrator Scare traveled along with County Supervisor Bill Zinnel, Representative Fairway, positive response there. Any questions on the commission, the presentation? Item number three, earmark that I just mentioned. When we presented to the DOT Commission and Council Bluffs, we made it clear that we are open and willing, but we made it also clear that it was going to be this council that we approved it. So nothing has been committed, or I don't want to say committed 100% from us, but at the same time, that's just the earmark that we already discussed at the last council meeting.
The other thing I would add is talking with DOT staff at the meeting over in Council Bluffs, they were pleased that you, the council was considering this earmark to go toward the overpass project. They know it, obviously, in order to get to move up to 2021. They have all their earmarks ready to go to DC. They're waiting for this vote so that they can send them all. So hopefully tonight there'll be a vote if council so chooses to approve it. I will notify DOT staff tomorrow that it was approved, and they can start sending their paperwork and everything for the earmarks to DC.
And that will be the last of the thing that our staff will have to do. Everything from that point forward is on DOT to do that, looking for us in DC.
I'll move to approve that $490,000 being repurposed for the overpass project.
Second.
Call the roll.
Stein?
Yes.
Mormon?
Yes.
Tripod?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Bird?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes. That's all I have.
All right, thank you. Next up, department reports. Polling official Ed Higgins is on vacation. Finance officer Andrea.
No.
City attorney Jim.
No report.
Director of Public Works John Rouse.
Yeah, just one thing, Your Honor. We started doing our improvements on 11th Street. Right, left of Harris right now, we're going to be doing a manhole. That's for the future project of the overlay. So we'll just start on that project. So. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, city engineer Dan.
Yes, Your Honor. Thank you. First thing is we have the latest proposed train layout for the rotary on South Rotary Street. The train at this point has been moved off of our sanitary sewer, the locomotive has, so only the tender is on our sewer, so this is something that we're in favor of. If there are any questions, I can take them, otherwise we're looking for a motion to approve this.
Thank you.
I'm sure you're going to know.
Motion to approve?
I'll make a motion to approve the layout.
Second.
Call the roll.
Mormon?
Yes.
Tripod?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Bird?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Well, next on the list is a potential agreement for the rotary. I mean, that's something that is. So this is just an agreement that covers the placement of the train there. Maybe I'll open it up before.
Sure. So the utility committee asked us to put this together. Jim put this together. There are a few things in here that I thought was important that the rotary committee see before we move forward so that we can have a discussion on it. I talked with Dave Cook this week. I'm assuming you got a chance to read it, the agreement, and you as well. Are there any concerns or any questions for council in regards to this agreement?
Bill, once council has had a chance to consider it, then we would take that to our board for approval. I think the only thing we would ask is that if the train is damaged, we would have the opportunity to either repair or replace at our discretion. So that at our discretion, obviously it would depend on the severity of the damage. That we would have to assess it at that point in time, but we could at least be able to build that, and it would help us out.
Yeah, I can do that.
Okay. So motion to approve. We need a motion to approve this agreement if council so chooses, with the additions that Mr. Cook just added. Jim will add those to the agreement, get them to me, and I'll get them to Dave for approval for his board.
We'll take it to our board at
the end of the month,
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Bird?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Mormon?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Dave, you got it?
Nope.
Okay.
Sorry, Your Honor, would you have, could I just update the council on just a couple of points on the...
Absolutely.
On the lawful term?
Sure.
My council is passing those around, I just, there's just a couple, updates, I think, mayor and city council would be interested in on this project. Fox Engineering has been working diligently with the Iowa DOT, City of Boone, and Associated Utilities to help finalize the site plan. We're currently awaiting comments on the latest, plan from the DOT. Sandblasting has been completed on the passenger car, and that's now, undercover and awaiting paint. We received a generous donation from Arnold Motor Supply, and one of the nice things that they're doing is the paint that's going to be used, not only is it going to be the highest quality, but if we ever have to deal with a situation where, someone goes out and tags that drain, they told us that they will be able to produce, relatively short period of time, a can of matching paint that we will be able to go out and go back over it so that, people's first impression of that drain will not be damaged for long. So we really appreciate their help. Boone's Welcome Train, we were recognized earlier today at Prairie Meadows with a $20,000 community betterment grant. We just really appreciate their help and support. We also received an additional $25,000 matching grant from Fairway and a $15,000 grant from Boone County Community Endowment along with Grove Green County. So it's just terrific to see not only the support in this community, which has been terrific, but support from outside the community for people who want to see us make this happen. Just to give you a quick total, so funds raised to date, we've raised $174,801, and that does not include the pro bono work that Fox Engineering has done, which this project had never been done without their support. Last couple points, we had a key stakeholders meeting a couple weeks ago. We really appreciate Bill Scare, Dan Scott, Greg Picklap, Chief Weebles, all of your help. And that group, our goal is to basically work together in a public-private way to ensure the safe move of that train from its current location at the Boone Scenic Valley Railroad out to Highway 30. Finally, we've been in contact with Allison Smythe of the DOT, and she's asking, and Bill, I'll follow up with you, she's asking to see if we can facilitate getting a meeting together with the city, Rotary, obviously Fox Engineering, and I believe it's Dr. Pollard, so that we can work through an agreement before the train is moved. That'll address public safety and some other issues as far as the movement of that train, which we think is exactly what the timing is perfect. Regarding timing of the project, our hope is that we can get the site prepared this fall. That is pending. We can't do anything until we have final approval from the DOT. But if we can do that, I know Dan mentioned, Scott mentioned at our meeting, something we had not really considered, which is if we can move that train after the ground's frozen, it helps to protect the city streets, the infrastructure, and it should also lower our moving costs as well. So we have taken that into consideration, and if they believe that's best, that's exactly what we're going to do. So that's all I have, and I'll be happy to answer any questions that the council might have.
Any questions? That's impressive, $174,000.
Yep.
That's awesome.
Great job.
So I mean, people in this community and outside this community, they love this project, which is great. And I can tell you, when you guys supported it with the hotel motel tax, we came away so pumped when you guys did that, because it said that we had support. support of the city. So we just, we really appreciate it.
Thank you for all the hard work, too.
Thank you.
Great job, guys. Okay, Dan, you're still up.
All right, thank you.
Okay, next is an update on the Plymouth Street Water Tower painting project. So our contractor is in town, so they're working on putting the containment structure around the tower, which is necessary because it has some nice paint, so we're working on that. And then we'll go on to the pressure washing. Hopefully that'll all be done by the end of the month. And then we can move into painting in the month of October, hopefully be completely done in September. So that's kind of the general schedule update.
And hydro flushing stopping during the project, right?
Correct, so the tower is great.
We finished our, once we finish that round, we're gonna stop, so about, yeah.
Yeah. Any other questions on? Okay, finally, we have the final class for test and displays.
It's not loaded. Do you have a copy of it? Can you just?
I do.
Give it to one and let them pass it around while you talk.
Sure, this is in everyone's packet, but. This has been approved by city staff and it's, I think it's ready for your approval, so we're looking for.
I think the only change on there from before is the loop that they put in on the water line, is that correct?
Correct, that's included.
Sorry, guys, it's not loaded.
No.
So, okay.
And then is there, you guys are still fine with that straight-in on the, I mean, road they're putting in instead of roundabout or anything or full set or?
Yes.
Okay.
With that parking lot being there, do you need any?
Go ahead. Good for motion?
Yes.
Make a motion to approve just more place class that's sent by staff.
Second.
Call the roll.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Bird?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Klein?
Yes.
Mormon?
Yes.
Tecla?
Yes.
Thank you, Dan. Next up, public safety, Chief Adams.
Yes, Your Honor. First thing, I must apologize. I was out to the public EP, so I'm kind of a sweaty t-shirt. I didn't have time to get changed. I apologize. What I wanted to update council with tonight is the last few years we've been budgeting through the council for our SCBA replacements, which is our self-contained breathing apparatus. We wear these into the fires, confined spaces, hazardous materials area. What the great thing is the advancements in safety today is unbelievable. The technology that's built into this thing is unbelievable. We just had our training today. Scott representatives from Minnesota 3M were down here because they wanted to invest in our community because there's some technology upgrades that we're the first that are coming out. They just upgraded this whole system. This is a 45-minute bottle, 4,500 PSI air pack. Our previous ones were 2216 30-minute bottles, which might not mean a lot to you, but actually what that does is it gives us extra time inside those buildings. Not so much to work longer, but the biggest thing is we have a downed firefighter. Somebody gets hurt in the building, they have extra air, they have extra capacity that their time until another firefighter can get to them is greater. And so that's one of the greatest advancements we have. The other thing that it has is, that is, to me, out of this world, is I can watch from outside the building everything that's going on. This relays back, it Bluetooths in, it goes 1,100 to 1,500 feet line of sight, depends on how the buildings are. But I can watch all the firefighters in there, I can watch how much air they're consuming, I can watch how hot they are, I can watch in the event, or I can't watch, but what I can do is in the event that our radios fail, and we have a building that we need everybody to get out of the building, if they can't hear our regular evacuation procedures, I click a button on here, this air pack gets really loud, starts buzzing, they know to get out. If they are downed and they hit their emergency button, this starts to beep and flash and do all sorts of things to me. So the advancements are second to none. The other thing that's pretty awesome, I'm gonna pass this around, and it's really hard to see. If you don't want to stick your face in here, I totally understand. It's new, the rubber kind of stinks. But what these masks are, we purchased 10 of these, is they have the thermal imaging built right in. If anybody's been to the fire department and seen in the years past, is we have a thermal imaging camera we hold in our hand, we look it up. Now it's built right into the mask. So these guys, it's one extra piece of equipment we don't have to carry in. We can work on getting through equipment. They can see, so as their head is moving, they're seeing real time what's going on. Another cool thing, I can Bluetooth right into this thing and watch them go through there. So I can be virtual firefighting, I guess, from the outside, or the incident commander, not only myself. But I just want to kind of pass this around. The biggest thing that I really want to come tonight and talk to you is just thank you because this was a $218,000 project, and it couldn't have been possible without you guys and the budgeting that you allowed us to do and over the years of putting money away, just like we are with the fire truck. And so I really appreciate council and the support for the fire department behind this project. So,
how many units do you have?
So we were able to, we have 26 of these units, which fills all the spaces on our trucks. And that's something that we didn't have either in the past, is we were about six seats short, what we call six riding positions short of air packs. So we were able to fulfill those other six riding positions. So, but.
And that's how much is everything?
What? $218,000 is everything. A mask, they're all new masks. We had to upgrade. One of the reasons this project came along is these are only good for 15 years. It stinks that you spend $220,000 in 15 years, we get to probably spend $260,000 the way the price of this stuff is going up. But the advancements is really just something that is out of this world right now. So
heavy is it?
How heavy is it? This right now is probably about 52 pounds. So all together with our gear, you consistently add about another 100 pounds to the firefighter. So.
So the IV that you see on here, that IV's the firefighter.
Yep.
That comes from their mask?
No, it comes from here. They have an RFID card that they will carry. As soon as they put the pack on, it syncs to to this pack.
Okay.
And then their name, picture of them, everything comes right up on my computer.
Good, I'm aware of that.
Yep. So.
No, that's great. I think that's a great asset that we have.
Yeah. So you get trained with it today?
We trained with it today. Obviously, it's a lot different than what we've been used to. The pack wears the same. It's the functions that everybody has to get used to, and knowing what all the this is called the command center, and what all this means when I send a message back or they send a message to me. So that'll take a little getting used to. But
now, is the video recorded?
The video is recorded.
Okay.
Yep. It's not recorded. Well, we thought it was recorded into here. But it actually is an app that it records onto it downloads into the cloud.
And then you can get it, you can access it.
I can access, yeah, we can go back and access it. So it's pretty cool to be able to see what's going on inside.
That's good stuff.
So. Any other questions? Again, thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
You bet. Yeah, I'm not going to carry it now.
Okay, next up, Chief Rubel.
No report, Your Honor.
Okay. City Administrator Bill.
Thank you, sir. Just an update on 8th and Story Street. We took bids for the concrete, got those back. The bid was awarded to Second Concrete in the amount of $40,750 for all the concrete at the site of what we plan on putting in. That includes replacing four panels of sidewalk near it that needs to be replaced as well. And Councilman Morgan, we have some further updates.
Just so you know, that price was a little bit higher than we anticipated. I had talked to the administrator Scare about it. I figured it would come in somewhere between 35 and 40, and it was pretty close. But we did add some stuff. We added mats. Ed and I talked about it and thought that was prudent to do so that it was long-lasting. And that elevated pad required quite a bit of forming and additional concrete. So. It's not out of line at all, I don't think, for the amount of work that's going to be done. And we expedited the schedule. He is going to start on August 3rd?
August 5th.
Yeah.
And complete on September 4th.
Before Puffin.
Yes.
So that will boost.
funds, sponsorship, the first question out of her mouth was, when? Because it's been sitting there for a while, so they're a little skeptical, and I told them we're gonna break ground, and they're still not too sure. But I got an electrical drawing to John, that will start soon, prior to the concrete work getting underway, and then we're going to meet with Lion, hopefully, and talk to them about getting a meter dropped in there and power, see if what they'll do for us, if anything. Fundraising, I have contacted about 40 different businesses around town, several individual people have donated, and everyone comes through with what they promised, and some of them have, I know some stuff's coming in now. I'm right at 12,000 raised so far, so not too bad for about 5 days worth of work, full time, I guess. But other than that, we're doing pretty well. In front of you, I gave you some packets. Inside those packets are envelopes and some of the sponsorship sheets. So if you know some people, your neighbors, your friends, your family, whatever, other businesses, contact them, get them a sheet and stuff. That would really help me out a lot. But I'm planning on having a booth ready, and I know Elijah said he'd help me with it, at Puffer, right down in front of the site. That should help with our fundraising. So I'm also in partnership with PWDG. I went down and talked with them, and they have sponsorship sheets available down there now, and he's just gonna do some added radio spots for us and stuff. I have a proposal to Boone News. I haven't heard back from Logan yet to run some full page ads with the sheets in there in return for platinum stead, right? We also have them available here at City Hall and on the website. So I'm trying to cover all the bases and get it out there as much as possible. And I know with the economic development, we're going to talk about this further about the signage and stuff for the spaces. So we're on our way. I'm trying to get that wall painted behind it too. We'll see. Craig's going to go out and work.
It's going to help when the concrete starts getting.
The results, when they actually see a shovel in the ground, yeah. It's going to make a world of difference. I'm also going to meet with Rotary. I have scheduled to do a presentation there next month, and with Kiwanis the following month. And I also have talked to Kurt. Kurt mentioned a partnership with the Chamber.
But just to be clear, the green space won't be open for Puffer.
It won't be open for Puffer. I think from a liability standpoint, it won't be ready. And then we're going to try to get an architect on board this fall yet, prior to Puffer. He said he would do some conceptual designs, which will help us with presentation. And then get him on board with design and stuff over this winter so that we can get a general contractor on board and hit the ground running next spring.
Great.
Maybe we could put a sign up and just say green space 2020 or something coming in.
Councilmember Stecker brought that up, and then also maybe starting a marketing campaign and a hashtag and get people excited and view the photos as they're progressing on the project, so that way they can see the progress online and then give them some momentum on fundraising.
They'll want to come back for Puffer next year and see a lot of out of towners.
I think when it materializes, people are going to get excited about it. So.
Okay. Thank you. Next up, consent agenda. Any items on consent agenda you want removed and discussed separately?
The one that's really on there is the minutes from the previous meeting. Not any motion to approve. And bills here.
So moved. Second.
Call the roll.
Gray?
Yes.
Bird?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Foreman?
Yes.
Kiprah?
Yes.
Stecker?
Yes.
Okay, number seven, ordinances. A, third reading, 2253, ordinance rezoning property located at 1251 8th Street from M3 to R2, and property owned by Midland Power from R1 to C1 and adjoining property.
Motion approved.
Second.
Call the roll.
Bert?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Mormon?
Yes.
Tickwell?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes. Move to approve, or move, excuse me, Chris. Motion to adopt.
Second.
Call the roll.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Mormon?
Yes.
Tickwell?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Bert?
Yes.
Okay, B, third reading, 2254, ordinance to change the parking regulations as they pertain to no parking zones and parking limited to 24 hours, section 69.0893.
Move to approve.
Second.
Call the roll.
Stein?
Yes.
Mormon?
Yes.
Tickwell?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Bert?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Move to adopt.
Second.
Call the roll.
Mormon?
Yes.
Tickwell?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Bert?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Next up, mayor's comments. In front of you have the two people that have been nominated for the Community Dedication Award. So at this time, we need to vote on which one you would like selected as our award winner. Do you have them done, or are you voting?
Tough one.
Yeah, very.
Very tough.
Yeah.
Both have contributed greatly to the community and done a lot. Just no question about either one of them deserving it.
So how we've done this in the past is we let the council discuss it, and if someone wants to nominate somebody, we'll vote. And go from there. But they're both great candidates. I could go on about both of them. I think they're both well deserved, and so.
And nothing stops them from being renominated again.
Right.
So.
Sure.
They can, if we decide on one, not the other one, they can always be renominated.
Any comments?
I'm a little biased because I coached with Daryl for 8 years. He loves the kids. He's been up there. He's an institution up there for 42 years. He's now on his great-grandchildren coaching. He also is a mentor, does a mentoring program at his church, teaches Sunday school and stuff. He's a good guy.
Yeah.
The
stuff that, stuff that Richard's done with all the veterans. My goodness, how could you not see it, the great thing that he's done? I'm leaning a little bit towards Daryl myself, only because I think that there's so many kids in this, well, adults now, in this community that know Daryl from his coaching and everything that he's done through the Little League. I mean, he's impacted so many young people as they've learned how to play and how to be a team, and how that makes you a better person. And I know he's, besides all that, he worked for the city for a lot of years. He was a very loyal employee.
His diversity of his volunteerism.
Yeah, absolutely.
Gets a skill for me.
So, in any event.
Would anybody like to nominate somebody?
I will nominate Daryl Cruz for, what do we call that?
Community Dedication.
Yes. That.
Second.
Call the roll.
Tickwell?
Yes.
Stucker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Bert?
Yes.
McGinn?
Yes.
Stein?
Yes.
Mormon?
Yes.
Okay. Are there any council comments this evening?
Well, I have something. All in all, this has been a really positive meeting, a lot of good stuff coming forward. But we did have the 4th of July temper that, a little bit by saying that I have a lot of pretty bad complaints about fireworks usage. I was not in town on the 3rd, 3rd or the 4th. We usually go up to South Dakota for that, but I got two emails about it. One of them included pictures of a rocket going into their garage side. So, I don't know.
Yeah. Chiefs, I guess I should say. Please, what was your dealings with all this in the 2 days we allowed it?
Yes, I unfortunately can't give you a number of all the complaints we
right.
had. I know that, again, as in years past, several of the complaints were during times when they were legal to be fired. So the dispatchers don't record those. Outside of those, I can't tell you the complaint number right now. I can tell you that we did write at least one citation for firing them before the 4th. I think it was the July 1st time frame. Shortly after they started selling them, we had some complaints and we were able to write one citation. But a lot of the times, it's within legal hours,
yeah.
And because of the ordinance used and sold, it is disruptive to the neighborhood. I mean,
right.
Simply, most of these houses are fairly close together. When you're launching that kind of ordinance, there's no way you can keep it out of somebody's property. That's just the way. I don't know how, without changing the law and making it so we can't, it's not legal at all. I don't know how you fix that problem.
Well, and I know that, you know, we're not dealing with sales of M80s and stuff, but we still have some
there's some big
items that are being resold.
Yeah.
In no injuries or fires, secondary fires that we were aware of?
Not that we were aware of.
Okay.
Like the police department, we received several calls during the allotted time. We received a couple afterwards that were just complaining more of the garbage that's left behind,
yeah.
the debris that's left
yeah.
behind, the bottle rocket sticks, the trash in the streets, those kind of things.
We've had cars that were hit by things falling down, leaving marks on them. Probably some mostly superficial, but we don't know. Some could have been scratched. Would that make me happy if it was me? No, I wouldn't lie. I don't want my car scratched. It's the whole issue here that really truly bothers me is that I don't want to impede on people's rights and their abilities to have fun and celebrate. We gave it a try a year ago. We gave them all the time in the world. It was just a mess. We lowered it down. We're still going to have complaints. And again, as I've said before, this is one of the things that the legislature does. But it's on our backs, and we have to deal with it. And
I will tell you that the amount of people that were selling fireworks this year, there was half the stands this year as there was last year.
Mm-hmm.
And to that caveat, to my knowledge, none of them received a state inspection, state required inspection before opening.
Yeah.
But the law was changed to
right.
reflect.
Right.
And also, I think some of the problem when we get calls is within a lot of time, days and time frames, and there is damage, a lot of times almost all those times, it doesn't rise to the level of criminality because there's no intent to cause damage to somebody else's
right.
home. The damage is caused because they're firing a massive ordnance in a city limits with, you know, buildings nearby and homes nearby, vehicles and all that thing, stuff nearby. So,
but it has to be on the private property. It can't be in the public right of way. I mean,
correct.
Someone saw one of those Nebraska Husker launchers go off in the middle of the intersection.
Sure.
They're in violation of the
right.
decided, right?
Right. For the fireworks ordinance, but if any damage occurred,
right,
does it fall under criminal mischief because there has to be an intent.
And that's the inherent problem again, that that, you know, 150 people can't get figured out down there, that we have kids that, you know, they'll buy 100 bottle rockets, they shoot them off. Sure, it's fun when you're a kid. I've done it. But it's not fun when you're the neighbor down the street. The retired couple has to go out and pick up sticks, basically, all day, all afternoon to do their yard. You know, so, I mean, these are just things that I really don't know what the answer is.
know? I mean, short of us just saying that we're gonna be like other communities, that you can't do it here, sorry. There again, I hate impeding the right that is guaranteed, that the state passes, but, you know, what do you do? You know, I mean.
As I've been thinking about this.
The most complaints I had were going late, you know? And I had a few people in my ward, I mean, my ward sounded like a war zone.
Oh, yeah.
And they went late, but I knew with the weather, the way it was, it was gonna go late. You know, they rained them out for a while, so they, I knew it was gonna go late, it wasn't a big deal, but I got some calls that I did, so.
I feel it's more of a neighbor issue than a law. If your neighbor is willing to do that and dust your car out and let the debris fall all over, it's a neighbor issue, not necessarily a law about the fireworks. And the only thing that I could see going forward is a possible education on how to be a cool neighbor.
Yeah, I think the ones the police have dealt with, they don't care. I mean, they just don't care. And the emails I got with pet owners, and I get it, and they're hunkered down for a couple days with their animal, and then the neighbors get talked to, police leave, they wait, they start doing it again. I mean, it's, yeah. I mean, I feel for the people that have the animals, because I've seen it.
Well, really, other than an outright ban, there's not a whole lot of teeth for us to do much else on it, you know?
But it is too bad. But here's the deal, though, if we said you can't do them at all, those same people are gonna do it anyway.
Yeah.
I think we would have fewer numbers, because I think some people, well, I know for a fact, some people simply won't fire them if it is against the law. They won't. Some people will do it regardless, like they did before. You can even buy them in Iowa, they go into Missouri or whatever else and buy them and fire them off in the state limit. But it was significantly fewer, and generally smaller ordinance than what we're seeing now that it's legal to buy in the state.
Well, I think Chief Adams kind of touched on that when he just informed us there was no inspection, because they took that out. They're already talking down the state house of taking away our ability to regulate everything when it comes to fireworks.
Sure.
The same people that passed the law and said we could are now saying now we're putting too many hamstrings on it, and it's a top priority for next session. So there's not really anything we can do probably until we see what the next legislature does on it.
It'd just be out of our hands anyway.
Yeah.
This.
Yeah.
150 smart people, we don't know nothing.
Well, and I know that, like I said, Yankton, South Dakota is like the epicenter of, you know, Independence Day fun. No fireworks in Yankton, South Dakota. Can't do it. You know. So you still have a lot of fun, and I have fun lighting off fireworks too, but I know the American Academy of Pediatrics says there are zero safe fireworks for children. Even sparklers get up to 1,000 degrees, and one third of all the children they see with eye injuries are blinded for life. So I would be happy looking at not allowing them altogether.
If you think you got emails now,
that's fine.
If we ban that,
if one child is can see or has all their fingers, can hear, that's fine. I'll take all the emails in the world for that.
I'm kind of on your side on this deal. My dog spent 2 days underneath the coffee table.
Yeah, it's terrible.
Think about dogs. Think about little people who have to sleep during the day or night shift workers.
Well, I don't know how many people with PTSD either. So
how many additional calls in the police department have you got?
I've
got a radio. It was unbelievable.
Yeah.
I mean, it was like after the fireworks that we did, the city did. I mean, I went home and it was, I bet it was 2 hours just this call. I mean,
which was after the four.
That was the number one call volume I had was, look, we had to delay our fireworks.
Yeah.
Does that mean we get a lot of fireworks?
Yeah.
I can see the Facebook messages from the fire department asking if they that's the rules.
We did too. We put it out on our Facebook page that they were not allowed to.
Yeah.
I can't remember.
Heard
we still allow it first.
Yeah.
Even
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
That's
what
it's like.
24 hours. Never really had an issue there. That's usually so cold.
Yeah, usually it's all about.
Usually
it's
cold.
I don't know, you know, we got time till next year.
proceeded, you know, whether it's changes or not, make a decision then, go from there. But we have time.
We need, we should address it though.
But we